that, you know, people will say, oh, I can't read that book, it's over my head. And he said, that is the very reason why you should read it. Because if you always read things that are at your level, you will never improve yourself. You won't get anything. But when you read something that's over your head, it forces you to, like, pull-ups, right? The bar is over your head. And so as you pull up, right, it's really hard at first, but if you keep trying, it gets easier and easier. You can do more and more. Now, one of the things St. Augustine said about his education, and he was educated in what are called now, in our tradition, the liberal arts, even though most liberal arts majors cannot, if you ask them what are the liberal arts, they won't be able to tell you. Even though they have a bachelor's in the liberal arts or a master's in the liberal arts, they won't be able to tell you actually what they refer to. But Augustine wrote a book called, it's not really a book, but it's an essay on Christian doctrine, in which he argues that it was essential for people to know these language arts before they went into the Bible to understand it. And he identifies them as grammar, rhetoric, and logic. And what he said, by mastering these arts, he said he was able to read, he was able to understand anything that he read and to articulate anything he thought. I mean, that's the definition of a literate person. That they can understand what they read and they can articulate what they think. Because a lot of people can't articulate their thoughts. You know, I wish I could put it into words, what I'm trying to say. But they don't have that. That's a skill. Some people have it more naturally than others, but it is a skill that can be acquired. It's not magic. You have to have words. You have to know how words are put together. And so, basically, what he says is he wrote this book for that third type of reading. He didn't read it for those first two. He said, if you're interested in those types of reading, don't bother with this book. You're just wasting your time. And so what he says is the first thing he talks about reading, the word itself. You have to know words. Because one of the real problems with language is that we simply assume, because we learn language as children, you know, we heard our parents say things in context, and we worked it out. We worked out what words mean in context. But words are many words are ambiguous. You have in logic something called an amphiboly, which is where you have double entendres, things, syntax that can actually mean different things, even though it's said the same way. Sometimes it's written, and sometimes it's how you speak it, right? Like, if you know, in America you have the right to bear arms, right? What does that mean? You can have a weapon. Some people could think what you meant was you have the right to take off your shirt and show your arms, right? Because in some cultures, women don't have the right to bear arms. Like in Saudi Arabia, it's illegal for a woman to bear her arms, right? So there's an example, you know, of something that's just, the language is not clear. Now, that's a kind of humorous example, but people actually misunderstand language all the time for that reason. And you have a whole set of fallacies in logic called the fallacies of equivocation, which is where things can mean more than one thing. We're using a term to mean different things. You know, to give you an example, you could say that, only men are rational animals, right? Does everybody agree with that statement? Generally. I mean, jinn are rational and angels are rational, but we'll just, you know, some people don't really accept those other categories. So we'll just say all men are rational animals. You accept that, Mahasan? Yeah. Okay, women are not men. Therefore, women are not rational animals, right? Does that sound reasoning? Yeah, okay, good. See, the equivocal term there is men, because in the first term, it's a universal term that includes women. But in the conclusion, I'm basically excluding women from men. So I'm using a term, right, ambiguously, which is one of the rules in logic that you cannot do. Terms have to be unambiguous. So what he says is you have to know the words that the author's using and how he's using them. And that's very important. So reading, what does reading mean? Like reading, what does it mean? I'm not reading you, Fatima. You know, what does that mean? I'm not reading you. I don't know what you mean, right? Yeah, exactly. I don't know where you're coming from. I'm not reading you, right? Or, you know what, Mahasin, you're reading between the lines here, right? I mean, we can use the word in a lot of different ways, right? But, and so there's a basic meaning, which is just to read. But if you actually look, one of the meanings in Old English for read is the fourth stomach of a ruminant, right? Because ruminants have four stomachs. And what do ruminants do? They chew the cud, right? And they swallow it, and then what do? They spit it back up, chew it some more, swallow it, spit it back up, chew it some more. So isn't it interesting that our word to read and to ruminate, to ponder things, has to do with this idea of chewing? You know, Bacon said that some books are to be tasted, some books are to be swallowed, and some books are to be chewed and digested. Right? So the idea that reading is something that's, it's not just this superficial thing here, even in our language. And that's one of the beauties of a dictionary of etymology, you see, because you can really get, you know, Heidegger, who's a German philosopher, said language is the house of being. What do you think he meant by that? Language is the house of being. I mean, first of all, what's being? How's he using that term? Being is a term. What is being? Existence, right? Everything that is, right, has existence. That's being. Like this. So metaphysics is the study of being, right? So when he says language is the house of being, what's he mean? What happens in a house? You live in it, right? You know? You live in your house. It's where you spend your time. So for us as conscientious beings, right? Because we're really, out of all these other animals that are out there, we're the ones that are thinking about what's going to happen to, you know, my retirement plan. You know, there's no birds worrying about their 401ks. They're not. They're not out there. There's no lizards that are like, oh my God, the economy is so depressed. You know, what am I going to do? You know, right? They're not out there. But because we can actually think about things, you know, cogitate, think about the future, worry about the future, like we language is where all this experience is residing, right? It's residing in our language. And he felt that if you could get back, he believed Greek was the, you know, the essential language. If you could get back to these ancient terms from the Greeks, you could really understand. Like if you could really get to the meaning of philos and agape and eros, terms that dealt with love, because there's different types of love. The Greeks distinguish. The Arabs distinguish. We don't really distinguish. We have to use adjectives to differentiate between our types of love. But other languages actually have different words for different types of love because they recognize they're not the same. So one of the really important things to have when you're reading seriously is if you're reading a great writer, because great writers, they differ from other writers in that they're very specific about the words they use. You know. And when you get into poetry, it's even more so because poets are not only using words based on their meanings, but they're using words based on their sounds. Like in English, we have mutes and liquids. Do you know mutes and liquids? Like ka is a mute. Because a mute sound, you have to have a vowel to complete it. Right? So you have a word like stop, p, you know, the P is a mute sound. So, you know, if a poet uses a mute as opposed to a liquid, he's doing it for effect, or she is doing it for effect. So just learning the sounds of words, of why we would choose stone over rock. And they're very different sounds, aren't they? Stones, stepping stone. We don't say stepping rocks, right? But a stone is a rock, and a rock is a type of stone, right? But when we think of rock, it's a very different thing of stone, right? So poets will even be more specific. But Great writers always use words very specifically. They're not sloppy in that way. And that's why modern writers, you know, I had a teacher, a Mauritanian, who said the difference between the ancients and the moderns is ancients wrote a sentence that could be commented on in a book. He said moderns write books that could be summed up in a sentence. Right? It's very different. And I found that to be very true. Most of the books that I read by modern writers, they really could be summed up very briefly. Whereas if you read a book like Qawaid al-Tasawwuf, you can't sum that book up by Ahmed Zarruq. Couldn't sum it up. Very difficult to do that. So it's important to have a dictionary and then a good etymological dictionary to deal with terms. So now let me just look at some of the things that he says in here. And then I'm going to do a poem with you. I'm going to actually do this in two classes because the book can't be, there's a lot in here. And I want you all to read this if you haven't already read it. And if you can, I would get the first edition. You have to buy it used. Problem is if you all buy it at once, it shoots up in price because used books, now they've got the computers, so they're very aware of movement with a book. Right, suddenly it's like $7 and it shoots up to 99 because they're limited. But the 1940, the first edition is, I think, much better. I've read both of them. I had to read the Van Doren version in college. But this one, I think, is a much better edition. But one of the things that he argues in here, at the outset, he talks about reading... And then he talks about reading is learning. And he says that there's no such thing as passive reading. You can't read passively. There's only more active reading. But reading is an activity. Watching a film can be completely passive because you're just you're receptive. And it can stimulate you, you can at the emotional level. Some films can stimulate you intellectually. I mean, some films, a film like Redbeard by Kurosawa is, I think, as edifying as a lot of books, in just terms of, and great film directors they have a purpose in making their films. They're not making their films simply to entertain, although that's one level that the film could be taken on. But one of the things that he says in here is that he realized after he'd gotten his degree that he was actually a poor reader. This already, he's got his PhD, and he was put into this class to teach. And he said that he'd read these books again, and he realized he hadn't really read them the first time. He thought he had. And then he was teaching in this seminar with Van Doren. And what happened was, he said he started reading commentaries and encyclopedia articles about the books. And so he would come, like, thinking he was really prepared. But he said most of the good students had already done that. So, and he said what would happen is they would end up discussing things about the book, but they weren't discussing the book. And he said what really, and he's very humble in that he mentions that it was a great blessing for him to have been exposed.